Help me give a warm welcome to Wei Chen. So I asked Wei Chen a question yesterday, and she kind of looked at me funny. So here's the question. Would you rather be a fearless pirate of the sea or a pioneering cowwoman of the West? And your answer was?
So just like a lawyer, I said define what your expectations are. When.
And the answer was she would rather be a fearless pirate of the sea because pirates have a group around them that they can accomplish the mission with, and they're not that lone person on the horse riding through the prairies. So thank you very much. We really appreciate
it. Thank you so much. Good morning. It is such an exciting feeling to be in this room. There's such vibe from this morning outside in the breakfast area to right now in this room. I'm very, very proud to be here. I'm very thankful to have this opportunity to talk to all of you about something that's very important to all of us, ethics. So I think to start, I'd just like to share with you a little bit of my professional journey of how I got to be here today. So I've always wanted to be a prosecutor when I was a kid. I don't know why. It was just one of those things, and we didn't have prosecutors in the family, but we did have lawyer. So I said, this is what I want to do. I went to law school, graduated law school, and applied to be in the Department of Justice Attorney General's Honors Program, which was the only way a fresh law school graduate could go straight into the Department of Justice to be a federal prosecutor. So I did that for a few years, and that was around the time of the significant transformation happening in the world with the Iron Curtain coming down. I actually, during law school, I was lucky enough to have an internship at the United Nations in Vienna, and that really just drove a thirst for international work for me. So after 3.5 years at the Justice Department working in organized crime and international affairs, I actually then moved to the Eastern District of New York in the United States Attorney's Office. And I went there because we in the Eastern District jokingly call the Eastern District the melting pot of crime. We have criminals from all over the world operating in Brooklyn and Queens and all throughout New York. So that was my way of being a federal prosecutor, but yet also getting a flavor of the international aspect that I wanted so much. When I was there, I got a call after a few years of being there. I got a call from a headhunter asking me to join Microsoft in Eastern Europe. And that was going to be based in Munich, Germany. So I thought this was crime would always be there, but this is an unusual opportunity that I had to take. So I relocated to Munich, Germany, spent 3 years there, and then kind of missed being in the United States, moved back to New York, and was doing anti-piracy work both in Eastern Europe and in New York. And when I was in New York, working with Microsoft, 9/11 happened. So I still remember that morning very vividly, walking across town, seeing the smoke from downtown. So I started volunteering, like millions of other New Yorkers, in the Family Assistance Center. And out of that experience, a strange thing happened. I decided to go and study theology. So I left Microsoft, went to Princeton Theological Seminary, got my divinity degree, and I worked at the seminary for about a year. And it became very clear to me, even though the study of theology was great fun, my personality was much more suited to be a lawyer than a minister. That was quite clear. So I called my friends at Microsoft and said, I think I'd like to come back. And they said, how would you like to do compliance in China? And I thought, well, that's about as different from being a minister in New Jersey as could be. So, sure, why not? So this was just in 2008, just before the Beijing Olympics. So I got there just 4 months before the Olympics, and my first task as a compliance officer was reviewing all the hospitality-related issues relating to the sponsorship, Microsoft sponsorship in Beijing Olympics. That tainted my view of Olympics so much that I just couldn't bring myself to go to a single game. And then I thought, it's pity that you're living in Beijing, you don't get to see the inside of the bird's nest or the water cube. So I went to the Paralympic Games after, and that made me feel a lot better. After a couple of years in Beijing, again, I miss New York, so opportunity came up for me to join Pfizer. I joined Pfizer's international investigations team and was traveling all the time, worked with a team of great people. But then after about 3.5 years, I felt really burned out. So I did something unusual. I left Pfizer and went to be a cook in Italy. Everybody said chef, you know, I was not the chef. I was the lowest person on the totem pole. I gutted fish, I cleaned artichokes. I was on my feet like 12 hours a day. I worked in Milan, Liguria, in a few different restaurants. And then I ended that, decided to take a trip to Brazil. And when I was in Brazil, I got a call to join Standard Chartered Bank in London. And the draw was, they would move you to London. And I said, great, move me to London. So I went to London, and when I was in London working after about a year, was when the opportunity at DOJ, Department of Justice, came up, and I thought this was really an opportunity to make a difference, and ended up leaving Standard Chartered Bank and moved to Washington, D.C. And then, as you know, I worked there for nearly 2 years, and we had an election, and then soon after the election, I decided that it was no longer feasible for me to work there anymore. So why have I taken this path? This is not a traditional path, you would say. It's very, very important to me that I get up early in the morning or late in the morning every day looking forward to what I do. I love doing work that makes me feel like I'm solving problems, helping people, or learning something new. Those things are more important to me than actually the traditional career path or compensation packages. And that's what's important to me. And what I do today is I like to help people live lives in a way that is consistent with the values that's important to them. And I think that's just not my calling. I think that's what we do as ethics and compliance professionals. So one of the most common questions that I always get when I was at the Justice Department was, what does the Department of Justice expect of our compliance program? My answer is very simple. The Department of Justice expects you not to be a criminal. That's what it expects. Now, when Patrick was talking about becoming a new parent, when many of you have had children, and you were thinking about how do I raise my child, you don't think to go to your local probation officer to get some guidance. I've never heard that. But when people ask that question, that's exactly what they're doing. They're going to a prosecuting agency and say, what do you expect us to do? I think that's the wrong question to ask, because the standard that you get from asking that question is pretty low. It's just not to be a criminal. I think that question also reflects a very literal compliance mindset, which is, what do you want me to do? I'll do what you want me to do. So let's look at the definition of compliance. I'm gonna let that sink in a little bit. The act or process of complying to a desire, demand, proposal, or regimen, or to coercion, conformity in fulfilling official requirements, disposition to yield to others, the ability of an object to yield elastically when a force is applied. It's obey, it's to yield, it's to conform. Now let's take a look at what that's like when you just do pure compliance without any other considerations. In the first 6 years of the Nazi regime, they introduced more than 400 laws to systematically exclude the Jews from German social life. These are just a few examples of the laws that were passed. I want to ask you, if you were a compliance officer in Germany in the 1930s, what would you do? What if you were a compliance officer at a school and you have learned that the new law is not to let Jews teach or study at your school? Do you comply with that? That was the government's expectation of you. That was the law. What if you're a newspaper editor? Compliance officer at a newspaper. Jews cannot be editors. Do you fire them? How about you're a CFO? Would you let Jews be a tax consultant? Because the law says you can't. Jews are not to be tax consultants. What if you're a CCO at a bank? The bank is required to help confiscate Jewish assets. Do you follow those laws? Now, we don't have to go that far in distance or that far in time. Patrick alluded to our own history. What if you were a compliance officer during the segregation era? Let's go even closer to home. Let's not look past. Let's look to the future. In 5 months, if DACA is repealed, many of you will have employees in your companies who have been perfectly good employees. They will become undocumented workers. By law, you're not supposed to be employing them. What are you going to do? What about if you're a compliance officer at a manufacturing facility and laws on clean water and clean water have been lifted? All the regulations gone. Do you go ahead and let your factories pollute the water? Because it's no longer the law. Without ethics, compliance is just following orders. And that's what it looks like when we just follow orders. Let's look at ethics. Definition: a set of moral principles, a theory of system of moral values, the principles of conduct governing an individual or a group of professional ethics, a guiding philosophy, a consciousness of moral importance. These are principles and values and guiding principles. I think the question for all of us is, what are your values? What are your values as individuals and as companies? What's important to you? What do you get up in the morning excited about? What do you see when you look in the mirror? I keep saying I'm the only one who has to live with me 24/7. I gotta be able to live with myself. And at the end of the day, all decisions we make is really made on that, on that premise. And I think one of the things that we need to do is really help our organizations and our colleagues and ourselves identify what are our values. Sure, companies talk about their values. Lots of words. All these very common words that companies use as their value statements. What do they mean, though? You notice a lot of these words are nouns. They're not really actionable. What does it mean to get a little innovation? When you tell someone, like, innovation is our value, what does that mean to them on a day-to-day basis? And someone recently said, if you have to put the word honesty on the wall to remind yourself to do that, you got bigger problems than that. I think one of the problems that we face is that many of us as individuals and as organizations are not living our values. Enron, for example. I think many of you have heard this. These are Enron's core values with integrity at the top. We hear these words and they don't mean anything. Nobody believes them. Goldman Sachs had a shareholder suit brought against some of the executives of Goldman Sachs. And essentially, the basis of the suit was to say that these executives have stood up at town halls and quoted their code of conduct, talking about integrity and honesty, and do right by customers, and certain of their conduct did not conform to these statements they made. And shareholders brought a suit based on a particular case that contradicted these values. So in Goldman Sachs' court paper that it filed in defense of this shareholder lawsuit, this is a direct quote. "The vast majority of the supposed misstatements alleged in the complaint, e.g. regarding the firm's integrity and honesty, are nothing more than classic puffery or statements of opinion." That's what companies think of their values. They're just puffery and statements of opinions. In some cases, people don't even know what their values are. So what do we do as compliance officers? I think it needs to start with people. We need to get to know the people we work with and think, really understand what drives them, what's important to them. Why do they get up and work? Why do they get up in the morning and come to work? Why do they work here in your organization? What is it that actually makes them choose your company versus someone else's company? You ask that question of your employees, you ask that of your suppliers, your customers, and that will begin to give you a sense of what their individual values are, and then you begin to collate them into your company values. Company values is not something that you hire an outside consulting agency to write for you. It always worries me when I hear companies that says, "We hired a firm to write our policies and procedures and code of conduct and all that," because that tells me you don't really care. You got some outsider to write something that's supposed to reflect your values. And that, of course, when that happens, then people who work there don't know what, these are not their values, they didn't come up with them. So they are not actually, they're not buying into the company's values because it didn't come from them. So you, as a result, you see companies and their employees making choices and behaving in ways that are completely contradictory sometimes to their stated values. So here's one, I swear. So Patrick and I did not coordinate our presentation at all. This morning was the first time I heard his, and this is the first time he would have heard mine. This is literally a screenshot of Wells Fargo's corporate values that's on their website. Look at number three, what's right for customers. Apparently, eight is great is what's right for customers. Come fly the friendly skies. Doesn't look very friendly to me. And this is a picture I took on my flight back from San Francisco. I was a little afraid he was going to beat me up. I was sort of angling my camera like this to take this picture because he looked more like a bouncer than he did somebody who was supposed to be servicing. And at some point, he was walking around passing out headsets, and I asked for a headset, and he literally rolled his eyes. That is not the friendly skies. Nobody gave this guy this message. He didn't know that our company logo is supposed to be come fly the friendly skies. The actions that people are taking are completely inconsistent with the values that they're supposed to be holding. So how do we help people choose? So here's the apple and orange, the apple and donut picture. So if I keep telling you I'm really serious about going on a diet and all I keep eating is donuts, you're gonna know there's some conflict there. Maybe I really wanna be on a diet, but I just can't stay away from donuts, right? But ultimately, your choices tell other people about what your values are. And actions and choices are at the core of what are your manifest values. So whatever you say your values are, that's one thing. But what people see, they don't know what your values are other than by seeing the choices that you make. And some of these value questions as exhibited in choices and actions are some of what drove the questions that we had in the evaluation of compliance documents. Because we asked about all the stakeholder collaborations. Who drafted your policy? Some outside agency or different stakeholders actually participated in drafting your policies and procedures? How well do your stakeholders communicate with each other? These are the questions that we're using to try to get the manifestation of how do you really work as a company? Do you share each other's values? One of the things that we try to do as compliance officers in motivating people to behave in a way that we hope is consistent with the values is by using fear. And that's why everybody comes and asks, what does the DOJ expect? Because compliance officers often say, if you don't do what I'm asking you to do, we're gonna get fined, we're gonna get prosecuted, and we're gonna get all this punishment. Fear has been the stick that compliance profession has been using to try to beat people into submission. Let's see how well that works. So, a psychologist conducted an experiment at Yale University. And the experiment had to do with getting students to get tetanus shots. He had two versions of the brochure. One was the high fear, one was the low fear. The high fear ones showed gory pictures of what it's like when you get tetanus, and it tells you how horrible it is if you do get tetanus. And the low fear version, just explains sort of medical facts and you know why it's good for you to get tetanus shots. And then they observed what the students did. Out of the entire experiment, both the high fear and low fear had the same reaction. 3%. 3% of them went to get tetanus shots as a result of getting either version of the brochure. Then they made a tweak. They added a map of the campus, indicated the location of the clinic, indicated the hours of the clinic where they can get the tetanus shots, 33% from both groups went to get tetanus shots. Fear alone is not going to motivate people. Information helps propel people into action. You give them a how. So how do we do the how? What I always like to tell people is we need to help people identify what the objectives of the exercises are, define success, and measure the results. So what does that mean? Let me give you an example. People talk about tone at the top all the time. And that is a little bit irritating to us because the origin of tone from the top was the tone, it was talking about the tone of the organization as set by the top. But somehow over time, it evolves into the tone as uttered from the top. And so companies come in, they show us the blah, blah, blahs that their CEOs supposedly said, that, you know, are drafted by compliance people. And we actually, in the evaluation document, changed it to conduct at the top. Because this is, again, the underlying theme. If you say you believe in something, what have you done to demonstrate that? Part of the message is that we want to just not see conduct at the top, but we also, more importantly, want to see how it's perceived. So if you're an organization that wants to have a strong tone at the top, define why do you want to have, what is that tone supposed to be conveying? What does success look like? So if you have strong tone at the top, how would you know you did? Is it by surveys? Is it by his actions? Is it by the amount of resources allocated? There are concrete things that you can point to that help people paint that picture of success. If we were successful in this area, this is what it would look like, and this is how we would measure it. And it would be really helpful if you had useful data to help you fill in that picture in a very concrete way. So you can talk about the amount of resources, you can talk about the number of hours or you know, the types of communications that you've had with your senior management and boards. You can talk about the compliance expertise that they demonstrate or possess. at the senior level, at the board level, and you can do measurements. You can measure not just one single data point of employee engagement surveys. You can survey your customers, you can survey your suppliers. There are multiple data points that would be able to help you measure how close you are to that picture of success that you have painted. By giving people pictures of success and telling them how you would measure it, you give them something concrete to actually work towards. It's like that map of the campus and the hours of the clinic. That's actually what gets students to actually go get the tetanus shots. Being scared is not enough. Once they're scared, they need to know what to do. And giving them the how of what to do is much more helpful and actually result in actionable results and measurable results. So this is what I like to think of the way how we put ethics at the center. When you put your values, your ethics at the center, it drives out to how you do things. How you do things is by giving people information to empower them, and the result of having done that is then you build trust. You build trust because people know what you're about. They don't just see that, they don't know that just by what you say, by actually watching what you do, the choices you make, the actions you take. And when you are able to actually empower your ethics and values of the organization through information, what you get is actually trust from your customers, trust from your employees, trust from the regulators, and trust from your shareholders, short-term and long-term. And I think that's, to me, the most rewarding part of the mission is for us to be able to help people identify their values and live them. Thank you very much.